Welcome back to the Changing Earth podcast with author Sarah F. Hathaway and co-host Chen Gibson, blending survival fiction and fact to bring you entertaining education that will help you dream, survive, and thrive. And now, here's your host, Sarah F. Hathaway and Chen Gibson.
Chapter 12. Cole woke early the next morning. Slipping quietly from the bed, he stood watching Cassidy sleep. Remembering the beautiful night they spent together, Cole forced himself to leave quickly. He had responsibilities to attend to. He swiftly descended both flights of stairs and approached the medical center. He found Dolores standing there in front of the glass window. Cole advanced and saw LaPierre sleeping on the other side. The blip for his heart rate was slow, and his breathing was shallow. "We tried everything we could, Major," Dolores explained sadly. "Then there's nothing you can do?" Cole asked nervously. "His bowels were destroyed, Virgis. It would have been a tough surgery before the quake," Dolores admitted sadly. "Son of a bitch," Cole exclaimed, spinning away from the window in frustration. He paused briefly before declaring, "I'm taking my team to California. I'm going to find his family." Cole left the room in a huff, marching up the stairs to find Monroe and Chappie. He found them finishing breakfast at the club. "Chappie, Monroe, get Higgs and suit up. We're going to California," Cole commanded. "What about LaPierre?" Monroe asked curiously. He'd assumed they would wait for the man to recover and join them before going to California. "He won't be coming with us now or ever," Cole exclaimed sadly. Monroe could feel Cole's pain pointedly. LaPierre had been like a brother to him. "Let's go find his family," he insisted. "Let's do this," Chappie agreed, leaving to go find Higgs. The four men met up at the transport vehicle. Chappie took the driver's seat and started the engine. Pointing the transport towards the mountains in the distance, they soon entered a graveyard of parked vehicles. Miles of the highway were littered with clutter, reducing the two-lane road to a one-lane that zigzagged into the distance. Monroe stared out the side window from the back, wondering, they just left them? Why would they do that? "Where did they all go?" Chappie added. Taken back by the scene, Cole shared in their amazement. "I don't know," was his only response. As they neared the entryway to the Sierra Nevada mountains, they approached a chain-link holding facility that stretched out for miles. "Oh my good God above," Monroe exclaimed, looking at the size of the facility. "It goes on for miles," Chappie said in amazement. "Slow down, Chappie. There's a checkpoint up here," Cole said, focusing on the man. The brakes on the truck squealed a little as Chappie brought the vehicle to a halt at the gate. The federal soldier at the gate approached with a curious look. "No one told me a transport was coming in today." Checking his list, he looked back into the vehicle, waiting a response. "I'm part of the mercenary force. We have orders to go into California," Cole assured him. The soldier's face contorted into an even deeper look of confusion. Hold on, sir." The soldier walked away quickly, returning to a small shack and speaking into a microphone. "Looks like numbnuts need someone's permission," Chappie commented sarcastically. The men in the vehicle chuckled at his statement, watching the soldier return to the vehicle. "Go on in, sir. Take a left, and you'll see the command building on your right. Gunnery Sergeant Nickleton will meet you there." As he gave the directions, he signaled the other guard to open the gate. Cole thanked the soldier half-heartedly as the sound of chain and wheels in motion sounded, and the gate squeaked open. Monroe shook his head in disgust. "Why do I get the feeling we're being handled?" "Because we are," Cole admitted as Chappie pulled into the designated area they had been sent to. "You guys wait here." Pushing the door open, he bounded into the dusty street. Slamming the door behind him, he heard the noise of refugees talking and screaming. A loudspeaker blasted commands to them over the noise, indicating the designated locations people should go to. It started again in Spanish after finishing the first series of instructions in English. As he approached the building, he was met by a giant of a man. He stood at least 6 feet tall with broad shoulders. It was evident he was no stranger to exercise, and his muscles bulged under his uniform. His jaw was square, but his eyes were kind. "Major Virgis?" the man asked. "Yes, sir, and you are?" Cole asked, stepping forward and shaking his hand. "Gunnery Sergeant Ben Nickleton, sir. Merkley sent my squad here to get information on several refugee families," he explained. "Nice to meet you. I was wondering if Merkley actually sent anyone," Cole admitted. Watching the federal soldiers taking note of their conversation, Nickleton gestured for Cole to enter. "Come into the back office where we can talk." Traversing the busy office, they entered a quiet back room. Nickleton started explaining as soon as the door clicked. "The feds won't let us cross the line, but I've been collecting information on survivors. Who are you looking for?" He approached a desk with a laptop sitting atop it. "A family with the last name LaPierre. They were in Sacramento," Cole explained. Nickleton looked up at him and closed the computer. Cole waited patiently as Nickleton poured two drinks. "No one has heard of any survivors from Sacramento or west of it. Most of the refugees are from the eastern mountain ranges, or they were trying to go back into California from out of state." He took a long pull from his drink, putting it back down and refilling it. "Thus all the cars on the highway?" Cole wondered. "Exactly. The feds are busing them south." "They won't even let your team in?" Cole asked, taking a drink from the cup. "They say they can't guarantee security within the borders. They've shut down the state. If you can make it out, you win the prize of being bused to Vegas." "What are they going to do with all those people there?" Cole wondered. "Hell if I know. What are they going to do with all the people everywhere?" Nickleton asked seriously, making eye contact with Cole. Cole took another long drink from his glass. He had been pondering that question far too often. Cole placed the glass on the table and replied, "Guess we'll figure it out as we go." Nickleton looked up, concerned, as he replied, "There's going to be a lot to figure out. Hold on, here comes another quake." There was a tick, tick, tick of things beginning to rattle, and then it sounded like a train was coming through. The building shook furiously. Nickleton sat at his desk calmly, holding onto the bottle so it would not break. When the shaking subsided, Cole declared, "The East has been settling down. They still happen a lot out here. Hard things to get used to." "I'm not sure I want to," Cole answered. "I don't think any of us ever did," Nickleton declared. Cole stood from his chair, utterly diminished. They had lost LaPierre and 8 other men to get here and accomplished nothing. "Thanks for the information, Gunny. It was nice to have met you," Cole told him. "I'm sorry I couldn't help more," Nickleton told him seriously. "I'm sure we'll see each other again. For now, I need to get back so I can say goodbye to an old friend before I lose him for good," Cole explained. Quickly returning to LaPierre's side, Cole was sickened by the solid tone echoing through the medical facility as LaPierre's heart stopped pumping. Staring at the floor, he slowly wiped a tear from his face. "How did it come to this?" he asked himself. Back in Minnesota, he wanted to believe they could come out here and find LaPierre's family. But deep down, he knew they never would. "LaPierre would still be alive if I had stood my ground," Cole scolded himself. He wanted to give the man closure, but not this. Another tear streamed down his face. Dolores approached slowly, respecting Cole even more because he genuinely cared for his men. She spoke softly. "He died in his sleep last night." Turning away slightly, he wiped the tears off his face before he replied, "He was a good friend and a brother in arms." "Are you headed east then?" Dolores inquired. "Yes." "I hope you won't forget the kindness I showed your friend." Cole smiled at her warmly. "My offer still stands. I can have Merkley send a team for your protection. As you can see, we have enough protection. Just make sure the feds don't round us up," Dolores commented. "As you can see, we have enough protection. Just make sure the feds don't round us up," Dolores commented, as they walked back to the sitting room. "I'll do what I can. You have my word," Cole told her sincerely. As they entered the room upstairs, the club music was thumping loudly, and the bar area was packed. They went to find Cole's crew. Chappie stood up as they approached. "Time to go, boss?" "It is." "LaPierre went to meet his family," Cole affirmed. "He will be missed," Monroe agreed sadly as he pushed his chair back under the table. Clasping Monroe on the arm in friendship, Cole declared, "That's for sure." There was a moment of silence as they headed towards the door. But before leaving, Cole asked, Dolores, where's Cassidy? I would like to say goodbye. She left last night, Dolores explained as they walked out the door. You gentlemen take care of yourselves. Thank you for your efforts, Cole replied before hugging her and joining the boys. Climbing into the front of the transport, he was lost in thought, wishing he would have gotten the chance to see Cassidy again. Guess she's not one for goodbyes, Major, Monroe commented, seeing his preoccupation. Guess not, he agreed. It's just as well anyhow, he added, trying to convince himself. He listened to the engine roar into action and jerked a little as Monroe put it in reverse and pointed the vehicle back east.
Fish mocks. Fish docks. For the longest time, preppers have been looking for an answer for antibiotics in a disaster or emergency. In 2020, we watched the supply chain fall apart. When I met the team at Jace Medical, they explained to me how they can put a prescription of backup antibiotics into your hands. The Jace case is 5 different types of antibiotics. Unlimited physician follow-up for any questions relating to the use of these antibiotics, and a written emergency antibiotic guide that is authored by a board-certified physician. This is the antibiotic solution preppers have been waiting for. Go to jacemedical.com and check out the Jace case. Use the promo code PBN10 and you'll get $10 off your Jace case. All right, take your medical preparedness to the next level. Go to jacemedical.com and use promo code PBN10 for $10 off.
Hello and welcome back to the Changing Earth podcast. This is episode number 407, season 3, episode 12. So stoked today. Hey, Chin, what's up?
Hey, Chin's up, y'all.
Yeah, we got Chin in the house and we got a brand new guest for you guys today. I have Dane Draven with me from Draven Rock. Hey, Dane, how are you?
Hey, how's it going?
So, Dane, go ahead, give us a little introduction. I want to just really jump into info because we have a lot to talk about. We got your spot in the audio drama, all this stuff. So give us a little introduction. Got a book out there on Kindle. Let us know what's going on with that, and then we'll jump into some fun stuff.
Okay. My name's Dane. I have a podcast of my own, that I do every Thursday, or as many Thursdays as I can, called Gun to Armory. And then I also roll with my wife, who runs the Draven Rock Homestead podcast. I roll with her all the time. You know, pretty much every single time she puts out a podcast, I'm with her. We love doing the podcast. It's just a whole bunch of fun. We do it on Prepper Podcasting Network, of course, just like Sarah as well. I've got a book on Kindle right now. It's called The AK-47 Survival Rifle Builder's Guide. And it's basically book one in the Prepper Armory book series that I'm doing at the moment. The next one I'm working on is on the AR-15. So that will be out relatively soon.
Nice.
Yeah. I can give you some background if you want on me, but it's not really terribly exciting.
Yeah. Just as far as your firearms knowledge, how much have you been studying? Where did that come from?
I've been familiar and kind of raised around firearms since I was about 8 years old. Family members had them, always taught me, you know, proper gun safety and all that stuff, you know, like most people. But back in 2012, I decided I wanted to go to school for gunsmithing.
Okay, cool. And,
So I went to school and graduated, got all my degrees and certs and all those, you know, good little pieces of paper that you need to pretend like you're important. So I did all that training and worked as a gunsmith for a good long while. Worked as a manager, or assistant manager at a large sporting goods retailer in the hunting department. Kind of got disillusioned with all that stuff. Kind of just, you know how it is, you get tired of stuff sometimes. So I kind of took a break from that and started doing mental health for a little while, helping people out with addiction, PTSD, things like that.
Nice. So playing Mr. Lee in the audio drama is just perfect. Just playing the psychotic man is just right up your alley.
He's helping people, not having to put their hands on the desk.
Hey, man, that's helping.
Here's what's wrong. Here's what's right. I'm going to show you my having your hands.
That's called tough love right there.
Tough love. Jeez.
really tough love.
Very cool. Well, I need to say thank you. You know, Mr. Lee is a really, really pivotal part in the story, and finding the correct character to play that role is one that actually, you know, there's some characters that I can be more fluid with, and it doesn't really matter like who's playing them kind of thing. But Mr. Lee is one of these characters that, you know, I have a thought for him, and I really needed that perfect person for it. And you really filled the role well. So, sorry to give you, you know, so much guff at the beginning on I Want It Just This Way. But Sarah's kind of a control freak on some things. So,
well, it's your project, you know, and I realize that. And the way I look at it is like if I was building, or if I was having you build me a rifle, I would want it a certain way.
Right.
So, it makes sense to me. It doesn't bother me a bit. I think it's fun. I love it.
Yeah. I have already had, like, everybody was chiming up. Is that Dane playing Mr. Lee? I'm like, yes, it is. Bam. Another PBN host in there. So, yeah, it's great. Had a lot of fun with that.
Yeah.
All right, so we're going to go a little bit into the Virgis story today. He goes out to the edge of the California checkpoint now, and it is just a giant fenced. It was turned into just a giant fenced refugee processing center. And this is actually the refugee processing center where my main character, Erica, eventually ends up. And he's kind of seeing it at the beginning. And so I wanted to talk to you a little bit today, just kind of a brain exploration of government checkpoints. Go or no go?
Would I go into one or would I not go into one?
Yep.
Well, okay, so I think that depends on what I'm looking at, right? Because if you say government, I could be looking, and I can tell from a distance, as I'm sure you and Chim can as well. You can tell if it's a military checkpoint just by the way it's laid out.
Yep.
Or you can tell if it's just a civilian checkpoint or a police checkpoint, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you said government, which could be, you know, like state, police, whatever, or it could be military, right? So for me, it depends on the situation I'm in, if it's a go or a no-go, right? But ultimately, what remains for me, whether I go or I don't go, number one, I scout the location. I'm not moving off of those binos for at least 3 or 4 days. I'm watching that checkpoint.
Yeah, to see what are they up to.
Yep. I want to know what they're doing. When a refugee or when somebody comes into there, I want to see how they're treated. So, I want to see who comes out and talks to them. I want to see if there's medical doctors. I want to know if there's a linguist. I want to know how many guards are there. I want to look at their name tags. I want all of the information.
So number one, situational awareness, right?
Say again?
Situational awareness. What is the situation?
Yeah.
Yep. And Chin, you had a pointer too. What's your?
I'm saying watching for people actually being able to leave, not just going in.
Yeah.
Exactly. My man. Yep. That's exactly what it is, right? Because you're going to be looking for stuff like the concertina wire. You're going to be looking for sandbags. You're going to be looking for like machine gun emplacements. Are they defending or is it offense? Is it defense? Because every single like checkpoint, right? Every kind of maybe a traffic checkpoint or traffic control point even, right? It's always going to have those cement barriers that make the car go in a zigzag, you know, motion, right? Or like go in a zigzag so they can slow you down. What happens when they do slow you down? Or is it just state police with a couple of police cars parked in like a V formation and a couple of guys sitting out there? That I ain't worried about, man. I'll just go around it. I worry about that.
Right.
You know, a military, if I'm seeing Constantina, if I'm seeing some dude with a bunch of bars on his shoulder, if I'm seeing, you know what I mean?
Yep. Yeah. And then if it's a military one, it's like, well, would you ever get in close enough to be able to even see any of that going on without them having, you know, basically scouts out, circle out to be able to lift up stragglers and stuff in that area. It's a military one.
You're going to need good binos. You're going to need all that stuff. I mean, they're going to have patrols, around there. They're going to have drones. They're going to have, perimeter devices around. And it depends on if it's a hasty checkpoint or if it's a deliberate checkpoint too.
Mm-hmm.
It could be one that's just set up really quickly and they're just trying to see who's coming in and out of the area, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can even look at government checkpoints that are like, let's say something, a border checkpoint, like, you know, living in Arizona, I've been down to Mexico before and the checkpoint's coming back. Even when you're 20 miles from the border, there's another checkpoint, usually maybe two. And, you know, because they're checking for prescription drugs, they're checking for all that stuff, right?
Oh, right.
Even after you pass the border. So, but those checkpoints generally involve one or two agents, the Border Patrol agents, and sometimes you don't even slow down. They just keep waving you through, right? So it really, really depends on what I'm seeing. But I'm going to put the kill flash on my spotting scope, and I'm going to watch that. I'm going to watch that that checkpoint as long as I can. And that's just me, you know, depending on what kind of supplies I have, that's just me. And if I feel like it's safe, I still may not approach it. It depends on what I need. Why am I there? Why am I crossing through the area, right?
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
And then supply-wise, like people always talk about martial law. And I was like, well, the easiest thing to do is just control the food supply checkpoints. You don't have to control, like, the people on the street. You just control their food. And then set up barriers to them leaving the area, basically. You know, how they really blocks, those kind of things.
Yeah, as long as they hit the water treatment plants, they've got it all.
Yeah, right. I was like, because everybody's like, well, they don't have enough, they don't have enough forces to put that in place. I'm like, they don't need that. You don't need that. There's other ways to control a population.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, if anybody reads, like, after action reports from, you know, Iraq or Afghanistan, anything like that, that's the reason those populations are so easy to control is because they took after critical infrastructure, right? Electricity, water, food, you know, any transportation, any kind of critical infrastructure, they took over immediately. Airports, you know, train station, transport, any of that stuff, they took it over absolutely immediately.
Yeah. How about, so like now we're going to go deep. We're going into tinfoil hat time. We're going full apocalyptic situation and, a civilian checkpoint. So it's the, you know, it could be even a neighborhood that gets together. They put up a checkpoint or it's like a gang that's put up this checkpoint. You know, is that going to, my question is, like, is that more or less dangerous than even like a government checkpoint at that point, at that time? You know, I would probably lean to more so.
Do you want to go first? You want me to go first?
Oh, go ahead, Dane.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. So I got to agree with you on that, Sarah. I think in some neighborhoods, in some places, it would be more dangerous. Now, in a military checkpoint, government checkpoint, of course, they answer to someone, but so do gangs, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, civilian militias, things like that, they're going to answer to someone. But the other thing that these force or the gangs and militias and neighborhood groups, neighborhood watch, whatever, they have to keep in mind that if law and order comes back online, they may have to answer for whatever they did. So that's something to consider. But me personally, again, I'm going to be watching it. And if I need to cross through the area, I'm going to look for the opportune time to cross through the area. But I'm not going to look like an operator when I cross through there. And I'm probably obviously not going to cross through the checkpoint if I need to. But I'm going to try my best to look lost if I do get caught.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I might be more, I would be much more likely to approach a neighborhood watch or a militia or even gang members. You know, I grew up in South Phoenix or South Glendale, and I know how these people think. I know how they operate. It's not terribly difficult to have a conversation with those people. So I would say I would be much more likely to approach them than I would government forces in that situation.
Yeah, I would agree with that. Like, cause like even when Katrina happened, the Superdome situation, that's like one of my primary go-to examples of all time of why you don't go to like the place that's set up to provide assistance, you know?
Yeah, they start loading you on buses. It's not a good thing. It's a bad thing.
Right. And they were airlifting medics out of there. You know, I've talked to some of the DMAT teams and stuff, and they were literally airlifting the medics out because they were getting shot at inside of there. And so I was like, oh, yeah, nah, I'll take my chances in the woods. I'm good.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, yeah, there's so many factors to consider, but yeah, I'm with you there. I'd just take my chances being around no one rather than being around someone, you know? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, fair enough. What do you think?
Another thought would be, what's your purpose in approaching? Are you trying to just pass through, or are you trying to get assistance?
Exactly.
If you're trying to pass through, then you know, the neighborhood watch is probably the easiest one to pass by. The government and the gang might be a little more challenging because they might want what you got.
Yeah, no, that's a really good point, man. You know, neighborhood watch is just like, hey, yeah, if you're just going over there to, you know, don't care. You know, but the gang, for sure, they're going to want what you have. So you better be ready to barter with a prejudice if you have to, you know. But I mean, and of course, in that case, when you're approaching any kind of checkpoint or anything like that, don't think for a moment that you don't leave Overwatch for yourself. You never, never, ever, ever approach it with everyone you have. You've got to have Overwatch just in case.
Yeah.
You know, I wouldn't anyway. I mean, I would leave you or Shane up there watching me, you know, with whatever you might happen to have that could send something in there to make a point, you know?
Yeah, to kind of test the waters. Yeah. But then you could get your group split up though too.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. That's something that has to be considered, all this stuff. Hence the whole, like, I'm going to watch this thing for a few days and see what my area looks like.
Loman! You're going in! Bye-bye, Loman!
But yeah, that's just how I'm very patient. I've always been a very patient person.
Mm-hmm.
Just a silly anecdote on that. When I was shopping for my truck, my wife, like, just get a truck, you know? And it took me 4 months to find the truck I wanted.
Yeah, nah, that's just so not me. Only when I am on the battlefield, then I am very patient because I know I don't want to get shot, you know? Even when we're just playing airsoft, I'm like, I can just wait.
It doesn't feel very good.
It's coming more with age.
Yeah, fair enough. Mm-hmm.
Older I get, the more it's like, well, Sarah, I'm like raising pigs and stuff, and I found if you just run after the pig, if you're trying to catch the piglets, you ain't never gonna catch the damn thing. If if you stalk it, you'll catch it. You know, my neighbor's laughing at me because I just move in like slow motion, but it works.
That's
if you
true.
Try to chase that piglet around the pen, you ain't never gonna catch it.
That's what I do with the chickens too. You know, just a slow move, slow move, slow move, wham. You know?
It's like stalking a deer. You know, when they head down to graze or look the other way, then you move, and then you know, you can't just like run after it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Works every time. Works every time. Or you get some kale or some lettuce in your hand. Come here.
See, I'm thinking we can just throw like the cow catcher on the front of the truck and just like wham right through the checkpoint. Yeah, we're out of here.
No. Yeah, there you go.
Through the water, Sarah.
Fictional writer.
There you go. Get that. What was that semi truck they had in that zombie movie? You remember that one?
Yeah. The new Mad Max one. That thing is cool.
Wouldn't mind rolling one of those. Man. Or, heck, if the world went to crap, I'd just go get Stryker.
Chin had found us like the RV that was on like the super like off-roading wheels. You could just armor out that whole thing and be like, yeah, we're just coming through.
And nice sort of mattress in the back and a freaking off-road RV.
Why 50 not? Cal on top. Boom.
Heck yeah. Just commandeer a few of those off of some Navy boats. You're good to go. Yeah. Some of them quad 50s.
Oh.
Yeah. Y'all think just like my own heart, you know?
Right? I know.
Yeah. Like my own heart.
The checkpoints always kind of freak me out because, like, you want to be able to move. One of the best tips I got for travel in a post-apocalyptic setting is using the railroad lines. Because they'll go to the same places that roads go to, but like the traffic on there is going to be way less. They probably won't have roadblocks there. Not that you'll be able to take a vehicle like straight through there, but at least it's a trail you can follow. The only problem is probably really smart people actually know how to use it, or like homeless people that have been surviving out there for a while. So I would say there's a heightened alertness that you'd have to use, but
railroad engineers,
right? Yeah. But it seems to me like that's the way to go if you were, you know, I don't know if you'd be able to travel, so to speak, in a vehicle anyway because the oil and whatnot. So just depends on the collapse scenario.
You know, it's interesting you mention that because, like, you know, like homeless people or like, you know, vagrants or whatever that ride the rails. You know, one of my favorite episodes of like Fear the Walking Dead. Like, I'm not like a huge Walking Dead fan or anything, but the very first episode, or like I think it was first or second episode of Fear the Walking Dead. I don't know if you guys ever saw it, but one of the main characters was this kid who was addicted to opiates, and somebody said something to the effect of he's been living in a world full of zombies for, you know, since he got addicted. Nothing's changing for him. Nothing changes for him. He's already been in this world.
Exactly.
He's already ready for this, right? Mm-hmm. So it makes me think of those, you know, the homeless people. They're already ready for this. Nothing changes, really.
There's a lot less adapting you have to do. I used to take a lot of time to go down and talk with the homeless people, like down in the rivers and stuff, to pick their brain on survival information and like learn the hobo signals so you could identify, because they've already marked out like what water is good to drink, where there's good places to sleep, that kind of thing. So that is actually interesting if you go like learn that stuff.
Yeah, it's very, very interesting. And there's all these little hidden worlds, you know.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So I would say think outside the box, avoid the checkpoint. If I was going to actually like go to a checkpoint, it's because like I need help, like somebody's dying, or, well, that would probably be it, you know, if somebody, you know, my husband or one of my children or something, you know, where our medic situation couldn't solve the problem, that would probably be the only time I would ever approach something like that.
Yeah, somebody's got a really bad infection. The stuff you have isn't doing it.
Mm-hmm.
You need like legit military freaking medics. Yeah.
Right. Like, we need hospital care. Would you get it? I don't know, but I would. That would be like the only desperation that I could see that would drive me there.
And that's something to think about. That's a really good point that you make. Would you get it, right? So what kind of skill sets do you think that they might need in a collapse? What would the military need that you or your husband or your kids have, right? Like, are you good trackers? Are you good hunters? Can they not feed their guys? So on and so forth. Do they need a good gunsmith? So on and so forth, right? So all these things to consider. Yeah, my husband's got a really bad fever right now. We need good antibiotics, but he is a doctor. Oh, excellent. You know what I'm saying? So.
Right.
I don't know. It's good that you mentioned that. You know?
Yeah.
Did you get the help?
Yeah.
Let's think about that now before we need to think about it.
Tools. Put tools in your toolbox, and that includes knowledge in your brain. you know, because that's what you have in the end that nobody can take away.
Yeah, it's absolutely true. Mm-hmm. You know, I used to work at a place where we couldn't carry any kind of weaponry, you know, so I basically made the stuff that I had around me into weapons. And it may sound kind of silly, but every kind of tool that you can put into your toolbox, it makes such a difference, dude. You know, and a lot of people, you know, they'll see stuff like croutons and their keychains, things like that. But, and there's so much more you can do, so much more you can do with the tools in your toolbox, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You had a straw.
Hmm?
You had a straw, did you not?
Yeah. I made that, the last straw. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that was awesome.
And titanium. Yep. I'm still going to be selling some more of those.
Is it like a metal straw?
Yep. It was sharpened on the end, like a syringe.
Nice. Yeah.
You know, and then there were some other changes I made to it to make it easier to use in a in a worst case scenario.
That's really cool. Yeah, we.
Let's go to work with Big Gulp.
I think I'm gonna share some of our green screen conversation for member bonus content because we have some cool ideas. But I wanted to thank you, Dane, for coming on first of all. But I wanted to go into I saw The Sound of Freedom yesterday. The movie The Sound of Freedom. And you know what the movie The Sound of Freedom is about, the human trafficking stories.
Yeah, definitely. And by the way, you're very welcome.
Well, thank you. Yeah, again. I was like, yes, thanks coming out. When we do the binge, you've got great ones all over the place. But once episode 1-4 plays out of the audio drama, we're going to do a binge day, and I always invite everybody that's act performers in the show to come on the podcast, Dane, so you got to come on. But this is the first season we're going to do the bloopers reel. And yes, Dane, you bring it. That was epic bloopers, so... Now your bloopers are like household sayings around my house now.
So I'm awesome. Just glad. It's fun. It's so much fun.
Just some lunch. So yeah, some really good ones. I love it. The Chihuahua. Okay. So you guys got to tune in for that one. You will laugh your butts off.
Teaser.
Yeah, total teaser.
One thing I did learn, though, about when we're recording lines is, you know, because we used to go through and like cut out everything that we didn't need to send you, you know, and this time, you know, my wife's like, just send everything to her. So pick what she wants, you know.
Yep.
Like, okay. Yeah. Send it all.
Love that, because there's times when there's even noises and things that might not make sense to what we're actually recording. But then like, oh, I can use this laugh someplace else. I love that aspect of things. I'd rather performers just do it that way. So, and then I have some really great bloopers to put up as well. So,
I was racking one of my 1911s in the background when my wife was trying to record one of the lines, and she turns around, she says, "Stop doing that. You can hear it on there." I'm like, "Oh,
nice. Hey, I can always use those sounds in particular." I wanted to talk a little bit about the Sound of Freedom, just because this is near and dear to my heart. I first saw stories about Ballard. His first name is escaping right now. I believe it's Tim. Tim Ballard. I was first watching, it was before I wrote Dark Days in Denver, which is book number 5 in my series. And the story, hearing about the human trafficking that's happening in our world and the slave trade that exists on our planet, was a lot of my inspiration to make Mr. Lee's character and TJ's character. And I wanted to show people the world of human trafficking and just how much insane that could get if we were a lawless nation. So that was like the major inspiration to the whole end of my book series. So to go see The Sound of Freedom now on the big screen where they brought the story to life, I'm not going to lie. I'm a pretty tough chick. I knew what was the story was going to be. I tried to prepare myself for it ahead of time. I cried, and I literally, when we stepped outside of the theater, you know, needed that moment to just kind of like regain composure, because not only is it so sad to see, and then so hopeful when you see things that they're doing. But then you get so angry about how people could even do this, how, you know, people could even sell God's children. So I did want to talk to you a little to that, because, you know, humans are the new big commodity, right? So they have already passed most other trades. They're getting ready to pass the drug trade, even as far as it's a $400 billion industry. And a bag of drugs, you can only sell it once, but a human, you can sell 10 times a day for 10 years.
Oh.
Yeah. So it is sick, and it is sad, and it needs to be stopped. And unfortunately, the industry is exploding. So we need people aware. You guys, if you can get out and see that movie in the theater, you really need to go see it in the theater, because not only do you experience it with your community, but you're really helping them have the tools to be able to stop more of this. So now Tim Ballard has now rescued 6,000 children out of the hands of pedophiles, and he has busted 5,000 pedophiles in counting. And there was times they've gone into like Ukraine. There was a bust of 10,000 women and children that were getting ready to be sold in the slave market. So
you imagine?
Go ahead.
Sorry, go ahead. I was going to say, can you imagine how much self-control it must take for him to not just
slaughter? Yes.
I mean, wow.
Yeah. To see, because he was working Homeland Security, you'd have to watch videos and whatnot. You have to watch what happens to be able to catch those perpetrators and things. And, you know, you can't even imagine that whole situation. So I did want to say that there is a National Human Trafficking Resource Center hotline. I'm going to post this number again on my blog. It's 888-373-7888. I have already done shows on both human trafficking and recovering, so you guys can find information in my community and leadership tab in my survival guide. But I will put some more of the work up there. And, you know, it's up to us every day to be aware and to pay attention to what's going on around you, because these are kids getting taken out of every town in the United States. This is not a problem that just exists in other countries. This exists right here in our country. And
don't you also teach people how to escape from, various types of restraints and stuff when you're a prepper camp too?
Yeah. So I do the self-defense and anti-kidnapping class this year. I'm doing just anti-kidnapping class. And then I'm going to start launching seminars on the weekends for schools and churches and things like that, because it's my belief that if we can stop people from becoming victims, you know, if you can give them the self-confidence and the tools they need to stop the attack when it happens, then we're in a much better place. And like today, just today, we get Amber Alerts all the time here in Texas. They come up on your phone. And just today in Athens, Texas, a 14-year-old girl and 11-year-old girl went missing. So if there's something that, you know, that we can all do, it's teaching self, you know, teaching situational awareness. Don't let kids stand looking at their phones all the time. They want little boys just as much as they want little girls. They can sell them just the same. So we all really have to raise awareness and do our part to solve this problem. And going to see The Sound of Freedom is a great starting spot. So I just really needed to say that. It's an incredible story about these two kids that were taken from their father. And it's really about their journey and whatnot, and then how Tim fits into that. And, you know, they say when you go to heaven, all your good deeds, that's going to make your clothing, right? So Tim is going to be like in Jesus robes up there, man. He's going to, he's just going to be decked out, because what a saint to do something to raise awareness. And he's been a huge part of this. So, you guys, even if you don't want to go see the film, you can buy tickets, buy them forward so that other people that aren't in a good financial position can go see the movie as well. But you really should go see it and become aware, start having an impact in our world. It's a problem.
Sarah, I just put the ticket link in the live chat.
Oh, perfect. Yeah, perfect, perfect. So, and then I'll put it up on my blog as well. Yeah, it was just funny because I had started, I mean, it really inspired the end of my book series, because I thought, well, if I wrote it into my fictional books, I can raise awareness through my podcast and through everything. And now to see like so many people talking about it, so many people having a voice, this is how we stop it. This is how we change things. So,
yeah,
great job as far as they go for doing that.
Have you noticed how many of the mainstream media outlets are actually downing it?
Yes. I do have to say that CBS is not one of them. They had a great interview with Tim Ballard on the air, and so I did want to like give them at least credit where credit's due, because they're not one of them. But yeah, MSNBC and all that, that's pretty disgusting, how they were like, this is right-wing QAnon stuff. There is absolutely nothing that has to do with right-wing QAnon in any of that movie. It doesn't matter if you're left or right or male or female or whatever. If you can't look at that movie and be like, that is disgusting and we need to stop that, then I don't know what's wrong with you.
Wow.
Yeah. It is seriously life-altering. I walked out of there and I was like, what can I do?
Yeah, well, I mean, and so often people just go through their lives every day and they don't see what's happening around them, you know. And I love movies like this because it just slaps everybody into reality. Like, hey, this is real.
Yep.
You know, and this is going on right now in every town, in every country. And you know, you're doing nothing to help.
And people that are going to sit here and say, I need reparations for what happened generations ago, how about you turn your attention to stopping the slavery that exists in our world right now?
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Exactly. That makes me think of a story I saw. I forget where the documentary was, but it was a group of a family in India that makes bricks. And they took out a loan from the owner of the brick factory, and no one in the family can read or write. So they have no idea how much is left on this loan. And they have no idea how much longer it's going to take them to pay off this loan. And basically they're modern day slaves. They just continue to work and work and work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, and I think the cameraman said it was something like $500. I'm like, where is he? I'll pay the $500.
Right?
Let's let this guy go.
Yes. There is more slavery in existence today than there was when it was legal in the United States.
It's ridiculous. And people here want to complain about, oh, I don't have the latest cell phone. Seriously?
Right.
You know, people here are our poorest people here are richer than some of the rich people in other countries.
Yes. And
our poor people here have phones, they have cars, they have a roof over their head. They, not all of them. I mean, granted, there are homeless people, of course. I'm not blind to that.
And we're funding a lot of the business of it, though. We are funding it. We have, we have a corrupt industry that's funding the sex traffic. We have corruption. The green energy is BS. And there's a lot of slaves working lithium mines. Okay.
Yep.
And so all of that, I'm going to have a little piece on that when we get into our Changing Earth news. But a lot of our industries, a lot of our technology, a lot of what we do in the United States funds the slave trade worldwide. So we really have to wake up and start taking a look at this and going, you know, when you want to make a change, you need to change with your own heart. You need to make a, you need to make your own bed and fix your own house first.
Agreed.
Alrighty. Yeah. So on that positive note, guys, go see the movie. Check it out. It is great. And let your life be altered and fueled and let your fire come alive. So we can do something about this. All right. So, Dane, do you want to stick around for the Changing Earth news or are you going to sign off? You're more than welcome to do either way. I got to rip through it. Because
I should probably sign off. I've got to go take care of the chickens, but unless you need
I hear that. Well, thanks for coming on. Do you got, oh, do you, tell people again what your book is or do you have a website? You know, when's your show? That kind of thing.
I do have a website. It's called gunmetalllc.com. The book again is, Building the AK-47 Survival Rifle, or rather the AK-47 Survival Rifle Builder's Guide. Soon I'm going to have the AR-15 version. And of course, the two podcasts are the Gunmetal Armory. That's my podcast where we talk about, gunsmithing, firearms, tactics, all kinds of stuff like that. And then the Draven Rock Homestead, which is me and the wife, mostly her podcast, of course. Or we talk about homesteading only.
Beautiful.
So thank you for having me.
Yeah, absolutely. And thank you for all your help with the audio drama and all of that. It's just great to have connected, and I want to talk to you further about that project in our pregame that we were talking about. So let's do that.
Okay.
Alrighty. Cool. Well, you have a good one. We'll talk with you later.
All right. Take care, guys. Thank you.
You're Dane. Yep. Good show.
All right. Later, bro. Bye.
All right. Let's go ahead and get into some Changing Earth news. Yeah. Well, okay. Let's play the music first and then we'll get into it.
Oh, please.
All right. Not a lot of music today because we got a long show. There's so much I wanted to touch on today. I could have talked about any one of those topics for like ever. So it was rough trying to choose out topics today. Typically I was using other websites to bring together my Changing Earth news. And I want you guys to know I now have it on format that's 100% produced by Changing Earth Studios. So yay, we won't be reliant upon anybody else's show to make our show happen anymore. It's pretty cool. 100% Changing Earth production. Oh, except for Suspicious Observers, of course, because he's my son news and I really like supporting his work. So sun, quiet. Lots of sunspots exist, but it's quiet. It should be calm until the uptick at the end of this month for the beginning of August. July 2nd, there was a significant touchdown of tornadoes in Pennsylvania. So crazy stuff. You just don't normally hear about tornadoes in Pennsylvania. Even Philadelphia had a tornado touchdown. Very interesting. So I had to talk about that, bring that one to you. July 3rd, there was 403 earthquakes on our planet that were 2.0 or bigger, the biggest of which was a 6.2 in Indonesia. Chicago, Illinois, we were talking about the rain event there last week. And that rain event hold on one second. That rain event actually they had to stop the NASCAR event and that. So that was the most amount of rain. It broke records for flooding. It caused flooding on roads, basements, businesses. In the United States and Texas, we had 70 mile an hour winds that produced dust storms that engulfed highways outside of Amarillo. So that's up in the panhandle. The lithium mining is something I wanted to talk about because we've saw some big dust storms in Arizona and that. They are getting ready to open up the second biggest lithium mine in the world in Nevada. So this is a problem. This creates a lot of toxic backlash that will be impacting Nevada and Utah. It will affect it. And more research is needed to be done, but I wanted to bring that to you guys today because funny how they're shutting down all of our pipelines, yet opening up lithium mines. Yeah.
It's all about the environment, Sarah.
It's all about the environment, right? Yeah, I don't think so. So, guys, this is a big red flag for the United States. We need to be aware of what's going on here. Lithium mines are disgusting. Ugh, I really need to start talking about those cars and everything, but so many problems on the board at once, you know? Okay, in the United States, Salt Lake City saw a huge dust devil right outside the city, and then a 6.2 earthquake. That was the biggest one of the day that hit Indonesia, was right by Papua province. It was 33 kilometers deep or 20.51 miles. No immediate casualties. On the 3rd, a 4.7 also hit Alaska outside of Anchorage, just 12 miles south of it. It was 17.5 miles deep with no significant injuries. And then a 3.1 hit India as well at a depth of 5 kilometers. It was Himachal Pradesh, Chamba, India. I'm sure I slaughtered the heck out of that, but that's where it was. In the United States, there was wildfire concerns in Lincoln County, Oregon, and Underwood, Washington. These areas were lighting up. And then in Russia, there was a state of emergency declared in Siberia. They've had 110 forest fires across 61,000 hectares or 151,000 acres. In Arizona, they had two storms combined in Pinal County, to the most intense haboob in Arizona history. I guess I should have kept Dane on for that one, so that we could have talked about that, see if it hit him at all. Okay, on the 4th, we saw 405 earthquakes that were 2.0 or bigger, the biggest of which was a 5.3 in the South Pacific Ocean by Tongapu. Massive sandstorm engulfed Hamai City in China. Azerbaijan was hit with a 5.4 off the coast. Northern California was hit with a 3.9 off the coast. And India was hit with a 4.7. In China, there are thousands of people displaced by flooding right now. It has gotten really, really bad. At least 15 people have died. This is the northeastern area of China. By Mongolia, that's getting a ton of rain and just causing some severe disasterage up there. In Oregon, there was 10 homes destroyed in a wildfire by Skamania County. Skamania, and that's in Oregon. And then Massachusetts also saw flash flooding on the 4th. On the 5th, there was 778 earthquakes that were 2.0 or bigger. That is a seriously large amount, guys. Probably one of the biggest I've seen. The biggest of the day was a 5.1 in the Indian Ocean near Indonesia. A series of 3.0 or bigger rocked Iceland. So they're watching the volcanic activity there. Just a huge outbreak. And then Melbourne, Australia, down by our good buddy Ellen, had also been experiencing some earthquakes. They had a 4.6 and a 2.6. The Saharan dust is moving in on the southern United States. So every year it comes across the ocean and comes on over here, and we are seeing a significant impact on southern Texas, and then it's going to start marching towards Florida. So that is the story that's been going on for the week as far as that goes. Amsterdam in the Netherlands was hit by a serious storm. One person was killed when a tree fell on her car. The city just got rocked. They had a lot of property damage and trees down. There was also a wildfire that broke out in just north of Kingman, Arizona on the 5th. And then Japan got hit with another severe storm. And the big conversation out of Japan has been that they're getting ready to release a bunch of radioactive water out of Fukushima. So South Korea is all up in arms about that. They're not very thrilled, but they're trying to go through the proper testing to make sure that's a safe situation for everybody. On July 6th, there was 699 earthquakes that were 2.0 or bigger, the biggest of which was a 6.0 in the Banda Sea near Indonesia. The Mongolian capital got hit with flooding, absolutely devastating, and there was more rain coming down in northern China, so the situation just got a little bit worse. There were some weird earthquakes going on. Virginia actually got hit by two earthquakes this week. They had a 2.7 there, and then there was a 4.8 in the Philippines off the coast of Zambales, and a 5.8 in Chile on the Chile-Argentina border. There was severe flooding and thunderstorms in Arkansas as well. And then on the 7th, there was 680 earthquakes that were 2.0 or bigger, the biggest of which was a 5.0 in the South Pacific Ocean near Tonga. A 4.3 earthquake hit Pakistan as well. There was major flooding in Spain with vehicles being just washed away, big-time flooding going on in Zaragoza. In the United States, Montana got hit with heavy storms and hail up there. And Indonesia was also hit in the Lumajang Regency. They've been having really heavy rain, but they have volcanoes that are erupting there as well. So when the rain comes down on the volcanic, it makes the slurry called the lahar. And the lahars have been just taking out villages there. So not a good situation. That's basically like concrete rolling down the mountainside at you. The Canadian wildfires are still breaking records for the most landmass burn in Canada, most evacuations, and the biggest cost of fires. This year, they've had a total of 3,412 fires. They have had 8.8 million hectares. Hectares is the big measurement, right? That equates to 27.7 million acres burned. That is some serious burnage going on up there. One thing to note, on June 21st, Colorado broke the record for the most tornadoes in one day in Colorado. They had 36 tornadoes touch down in one day. That is crazy. On the 8th of July, there was 439 earthquakes that were 2.0 or bigger, the biggest of which was a 5.6 in the Philippine Sea by Taiwan. Northwestern Calgary, Canada was hit by large hailstorms and severe weather. Charlotte, North Carolina got hit, power out after storms. They were saying 60 mile an hour wind there. That was a biggie for you guys, huh?
Yeah.
Everything go all right at your homestead?
Yeah, I think we had a couple hours of no power, but nothing too bad.
Nothing too severe. Yep.
Nothing, yeah.
Yep. The 8th, that Saharan dust was moving further in, affecting Texas, Louisiana, Alabama, Mississippi, and Florida. We had a 3.2 hit Southern California by Lake Elsinore. And then there was two small earthquakes in Tennessee and that second one in Virginia. So very interesting. I was talking to you guys about the North American craton and how that's affecting the movement there could be causing fires, causing unrest along that North American craton edge. So it's definitely what we're talking about. Extreme heat hit the United States from Colorado to Little Rock, Arkansas. And then India is just continuing to get pummeled by their monsoon rains this year. They've had severe storms, flooding going on. So today there is a moderate earthquake warning for our planet today. And so far there has been 442 earthquakes that were 2.0 or bigger, biggest of which was a 5.6 in Chile. So to date, the volcano numbers are insane, guys. We have 28 volcanoes actively erupting on our planet. That is peaking at the most I've ever seen. We also have 27 showing minor activity. That is also peaking at the most I've ever seen, except those high numbers were taken on different days, right? So this is the most erupting, the most minor activity, and we're up to 36 showing unrest. That is a plus three volcanoes from last week. So it's just interesting stuff that's happening. And then wildfires in the United States. We currently have 142,000 acres burning from 18 major wildfires. Four of them are contained. New Mexico is coming in first with 67,923 acres on fire. Three fires and none of those are contained. Second is Arizona with 65,706 fires, eight fires burning, and one of those is contained. Colorado was number three on the list with 3,797 acres on fire. That's coming from two fires. One of those is contained. And then Oregon's coming in third with 2,005 acres on fire. This is coming from one fire, and it is not contained. So that area is starting to get a little bit more sketchy up there in the northwestern corner, guys. So keep your wits about you. Be ready to evacuate if necessary, and be prepared for wildfire season because it's coming. Alrighty. So sorry for the long show today. We had a lot to go over. I was excited to have Dane on the show. Always a pleasure. I've really hit it off with Dane, and I think he's a great guy. We're going to do some great things together. And of course, Chin, always a pleasure. Thank you for being my friend, hanging out with us. The sound of freedom, man.
For the music.
What?
I'm just in it for the music, the intro to the Change the Earth weather report.
You like that?
No, that's my
yeah. No, you got to go see that movie. Like, I can't encourage everybody enough. Like, get out there and do it just because it will help further the cause as well. So if you have a moment, go see that movie, The Sound of Freedom. Very much worth it. They don't have a huge marketing budget, so it's up to all of us to really share the word and get the message out there. So, all right, I'm exhausted. We had a lot of content today to go through. I was just like, whoa, this show is going to take care of itself.
Yep.
So, alrighty, guys. As always, head on over to changingearthseries.com. You're going to see new book, Virgis, is out. The audio drama season or episode two is out for members only. The episode two comes out on Thursday. All that's going down. So you need to be over there just seeing what's going on. Lots of great content. ChangingEarthSeries.com. And as I mentioned, I'll probably have some new audio up from the green room from this show. It was good stuff. And then until next week, remember, dream,
survive,
thrive.
Thank you for joining Sarah and Chen for this episode of the Changing Earth podcast. Don't forget to pick up your copy of Day After Disaster, Without Land, The Walls of Freedom, Battle for the South, Dark Days in Denver, and The Endless Night at www.authorsarahfhathaway.com. If you love the Changing Earth series and podcast, become a supporter while you're there.